Hey everybody, what's up? I'm Aaron. I'm here with my co-host Zach. And we are delighted that you would just spend a little bit of your time today to check us out. And you are listening to A to Z episode 84.
Today's guest is local artist Jill Waldrep.
It's like they're trying to be too meta.
We're gonna make them an offer they can't refuse.
Much better. Yeah.
Can I buy you a drink? You can't
just not. Well, he did pick out somebody we know.
Well, you sidestepped the question. That technology does not exist.
If this is your first time listening, thanks for checking us out. A to Z is a Southeast Texas local podcast with all new episodes out weekly on all major podcast platforms. But you can also follow us on Facebook and Instagram, other social medias as well, where you can find updates, clips, and a wealth of extra content.
Also, don't forget about our Facebook groups, A to Z Podcast Group and A to Z Movie Night, The Groupening, where you can talk with other listeners about episodes and share funny memes.
Yeah, man. Well, you know what? This was a really good one, dude.
I had so much fun. I had a lot of fun.
It was crazy because I really did not know anything coming to this one. I was kind of in the dark. You've been talking to Jill.
I kind of knew. I didn't know any of the story.
And I was totally cool with it. We really, more than other episodes, we really just got to kind of know Jill in this episode. You know,
it's so much damn fun.
Which she made a book. She authored. It's kind of an art coffee table style book, but. She didn't even try to shill for the book. She just came here. We just had a great time, a great conversation. We did talk about the book, but, you know, it's just one of those great flowy conversations.
Man. Yeah, and it's like we're talking about, like, female empowerment and feminism and sex positivity and being proud of your body. And it was just good. It was a wholesome episode where we talked about a lot of racy things, and your kids probably shouldn't listen to this one.
Yeah, I'd slap a PG-13.
I'd slap an explicit on this one, honestly. I think we say the C word.
Just for language, I would slap an R, but not anything else, honestly. It's PG-13.
Yeah, it's wholesome.
But you know what? Anyway, I hope you guys enjoy this episode with Jill Waldrep. Tell us what you think. Remember, always comment. It's hard. I know you finish out this episode on your Spotify's or on your podcast app.
You got to go all the way to Facebook.
You got to go all the way back. But, you know, we surely would appreciate it if you just gave us a little feedback. Mm-hmm. I'm sure Jill would appreciate it, too. Tell her you liked the episode and just get back at us, all right? Enjoy this episode. We're done.
You know, girls, it's great to live in a democracy today where freedom is everywhere. But, girls, we often take this freedom for granted. Freedom of speech, freedom of thoughts, and freedom of action. But you know, gals, just because a bunch of men signed that Declaration of Independence in 1776 doesn't mean that freedom was for men alone. Oh, no, you take Tom Jefferson, Ben Franklin, John Hancock. There's a hell of a guy for you right there. All these men had wives. They probably had a few broads on the side, too. These women wanted freedom just as much as their men did. But, gals, I wonder, do we? I think it's time that we women thought about it a bit. Hell, I think it's time we did something about it. So come on, fellow females of the 20th century. Be glad that you're an American. Proclaim your freedom. Stand at attention. Pledge allegiance. And... your boobies, get into the swing. Mount your boobies, the swing is everything. Makes no difference if they're big or small, as long as you give them your all.
It had like a cool, kind of a Rat Fink style, so I was like, huh, this...
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's like obviously a skull, but there's a million little, like sometimes I find new little things in there.
looks like Elvis. Is that Elvis surfing at the top?
Yeah, bummer. Dessert. No, they don't exist anymore. It's called baby cakes. It was like my goal to make it to all the baby cakes location. I mean, I'm not a vegan, but I like was just obsessed with like their model and like I had their cookbook.
It's a vegan bakery.
Mm-hmm.
What makes it vegan? Like no milk.
They don't use milk.
No milk. No eggs. Yeah.
God, that's gotta be difficult.
No. Yeah.
It's difficult with some things, but actually really easy with some. Like,
yeah, like cupcakes are pretty easy. Yeah. Like I've made
and brownies,
a lot.
You can make really easy.
Doesn't Jody? Jody does a lot of stuff like that. Right?
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't do anything vegan. It's just paleo. So it's like
paleo.
I mean,
Yeah. Sometimes it ends up being
vegan because there's like
by chance.
Do a big Venn diagram. It just so happens that like paleo is really easy to be vegan because you're cutting out processed foods and fucking vegetables or
paleo. Yeah.
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 See, baking is something I don't think I'll ever figure out.
You like cooking and baking stuff. Yeah, that's what I thought.
He doesn't. Mm-hmm.
Not that I've like creeped on you, but I just happen to know that about you.
We
well, you like you did the dat mac.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, I knew that.
We have a crossover with a lot of friends.
See. Yeah.
Well, creeping
yeah,
is fine. We wouldn't have found out about you.
Oh, well, true.
Creeping.
That's true.
Yeah. I mean, we stay creeping.
Yes, yeah.
I mean,
I draw naked women. For
yeah.
The
and
living,
that's
so.
See, and I said we creeped on you, and then it's like your book is Tits Across Texas, so maybe that's a little creepier than.
That's okay.
It's kind of okay.
I mean, I draw tits, but most of the time it's got like a body positive message. Every now and then it's a little raunchy, but that's because I'm a little raunchy. So,
I think I'd followed you with the A to Z page like a while back, and I think I'd followed you because I saw your art on like there's another page on Instagram that's called like Southeast Texas Artists or something,
mm-hmm.
and then they share. They like repost
art from other people. Yeah, they reached out to me and shared.
Yeah, and I think I saw that, and then I followed that, and then I think the first thing that I saw whenever I followed that was like a nice watercolor painting of a beach.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, okay, yeah, this is pretty cool.
Yeah. this is different for this area. What
yeah,
is this?
Let's go, yeah.
What's this girl doing? She cray. lost her mind.
Might as well kick it off with that. We're here with Jill Waldrep, and we're here to talk about your book, Tits Across Texas.
Yeah.
This is really cool. So it's like, what's the gist of it?
So it is a body positive message. It's easier for me to start from the beginning.
Okay.
It kind of came out of a personal experience. So that's why it's a little bit easier to go from there. I've got a laundry list. I'm disabled or a person with disabilities, if you will, to not. You know, whatever. Sort of switch that up. not claim it on myself, whatever. I was in a moment of despair after my second or third surgery and was on my bed. There are literally times that my clothes hurt me because of a nerve condition I have. And I stripped down and was just bawling hysterical. Everything hurt. Everything sucked. I have not always been an artist. I only started painting as a hobby when I went on disability, because I was bored.
Yeah.
As can I cuss?
Yeah.
I was bored
yeah.
as fuck.
Yeah.
I'm like I'm. Anyway,
we're not regulated by the FCC.
Okay, awesome. I mean, I just wanted to check. You know, I didn't know what kind of. I mean, I've listened before and I've heard, but anyway. So I was on my bed, stripped down, and all of a sudden I was like. I'm going to fucking paint myself.
Yeah.
And I had never painted a body before, never like really sketched a body before. I had done like cactus and flowers and some
still lives.
Some inspirational quotes. That's kind of where I started was like quotes on wood, you know, like I used to joke that I couldn't draw, but I could write in 12 fonts. that was always my deal.
Got a mean Helvetica.
Exactly. My Arial is awesome. Anyway. I was going to try to make a joke with another font, and then I lost it because I couldn't think of any other fonts. My Comic Sans. Yeah, there we go.
Oh, no.
Anyway, so stripped down, and I grabbed the closest thing I had to me, which was some really shitty watercolor pens and a little 6x6 watercolor pad and painted my torso. And it was not cute. There's a little snap of it in the book, but it... flipped a switch in my head. I was like, holy shit, I'm art. Like, I am not just broken. I am not these pieces that I think make up myself. I'm not just a disabled, you know, at that time I was 30. I'm not just a disabled 30-year-old. Mm-hmm. I'm not just a mom. I'm not just a wife. I'm not just this and that. And then I knew other women needed to experience that. And I'm sure men do too, but for me specifically, I knew other women did. And I thought maybe 12 other women might need to hear my message, you know? I was, like, going to reach out to Facebook, and that's where I thought it was gonna, I was going to put together, like, a little DIY. I'm very inspired by, like, Riot Girl zines and stuff. Yeah. I have a collection of some, like, 90s.
Well, you're wearing a hat that says feminist as fuck.
Oh, yeah.
Which is pretty awesome.
So. Exactly. So I was going to just put together, like, a little Xerox action. I reached out to my Instagram followers, and it turned into this.
Yeah.
The goal of it was to flip that switch. It was to make women realize that they are not their tits. They are not their ass. They are not their stomach, but they are this whole piece of art. That they are not, I lost the word I was going to use. Yeah. They're not their tits and ass, even though tits and ass are amazing, and I love drawing tits and ass, and I will continue to. We're so much more than that, and even though we want to be, like, it's great to be proud of ourselves, and, like, you know, I want 450-pound women to know that they can wear crop tops, and, like, that's awesome, but I also want them to know that there's so much more than just an overweight woman in a crop top, you know, or skinny women. I did from 98 pounds to 450 pounds, from age 20 to age 60. And all but two of those women were done in person. Two of them had to, we couldn't coordinate and they had to send emails. But everybody's experiences were so different, but exactly the same.
Yeah.
Like, they all needed that switch.
Yeah. And that's what kind of made them agree to do it, I guess, you know? It's like, did you have to, like, kind of give them a, you had to sell it to them, or?
Not really. I thought that that's, like originally, I thought I was going to have to. I thought it was going to be pulling teeth to even get 12 women. I ended up with 40.
Yeah, you ended up with a pretty thick book here.
Yeah, and that 40 includes myself. I had to turn some people away.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, there could be a volume 2. Because I've had so many people even approach me, like, if you do this again, yeah. Let me know.
Right.
My goal was diversity. Mm-hmm. I wanted it to be as diverse as possible. I didn't turn people down because of, you know, I had too many of this or that. I'd had to turn people down basically because of deadlines.
Mm-hmm.
But my goal was to just get as, like I said, I had the giant weight limit. I had the giant age group. And I wanted from all backgrounds. I have a trans woman in there. I have gay, straight, you know, pansexual. I've got from all religious backgrounds. I've got witches and Christians and I've got it all.
Yeah.
Seriously, it runs the gamut.
Yeah.
as crazy as it sounds, it does. And that was truly the goal, was for it to be this catalog of, Texas is.
You just wanted to be representative, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Extremely representative. And, that's what Texas is, too. It's, mm-hmm. it's a pretty freaking...
super diverse.
Exactly. Yeah. And it would be a shame to have a book about tits across Texas and it not to be about...
Across all, Texas, yeah.
Yeah, and not to be about all the diversity in mm-hmm. those tits. We got lots of diversity, you know? And I got fake, I got real, I wanted it all.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't want to just show off because, like... To me, there were some people that were like, well, why do you want fake in there? Because it's supposed to be about, well, it's not about natural beauty. Yeah. It's about what makes you feel beautiful.
That's a little exclusive, too.
Right. That's like saying I'm not going to include tattooed women because they did that to themselves. Like, that's ridiculous.
It seems like it's like the whole like body positive thing, but also the whole thing of being proud of your body and being proud of these things is like that. Seems like that message gets lost in people who, like, you know, they want bigger boobs, you
mm-hmm.
know, and then maybe the people who are like just trying to be happy with what they have would get upset at people that want to change themselves.
Right.
But it's not about that. It's just about the inclusivity.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's about, to me, like, ultimately, and it took me a long time to come to grips with this because when I was younger, I used to, like, when I was super preaching the, like, natural beauty message, it was like, why do you have to do this to feel like you're beautiful? Mm. You shouldn't have to wear that much makeup to think you're beautiful. You shouldn't have to spend that much money on surgery to think you're beautiful. Mm. Well, and especially someone who's had to have surgery not because I wanted to. I'd mm-hmm. be like, why the fuck are you having surgery? Like,
just elective surgery.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, why are you choosing to put your body through this?
Yeah.
I mean, I went through a stage where I was not happy with those people who chose. I mean, not happy, but
yeah,
you know what I mean?
You didn't
like,
understand them.
And yeah, like, and yeah. I was probably more judgmental than I would like to admit. But it's at a place now where it's like we all have an idea in our head of what we want to represent ourselves as. And whether that be someone with big tits covered in tattoos or whether that be, you know, clean slate, blonde hair, I mean, whatever it is that you've got in your head that you want to represent, just fucking do it.
Yeah.
And if there's something you want to change, it's okay to change. If you want to lose weight, like, it's okay to lose weight. But if you're happy with where you're at, like, be with where you're at and wear that fucking crop top. Like, it's okay. Like, wear your bikini, whatever. But if you want to change something, change it. It doesn't have to be a dramatic, like, you know, big deal that you're making a change. Mm-hmm. Like, just do it for yourself. Like, don't, you know, we get so wrapped up in doing things for other people. And that was another mission of this. Like, I wanted these women to know, like, I appreciate you doing this for me, like, for my project and all of that. But more than anything, like, I hope you're doing this for you. Like, I want this to be something that means something to you. And the answer most of the time was astounding yes.
So what do you think that all the women that participated in your project, what do you think they got out of it?
It was kind of funny. Whenever I would show them their images the first time, because initially, like, when I would go or if they would come to my house, depending on the situation, I would just do the sketch. And then I would let them see their sketch or, like, take a little snap of it. And then I later on did the actual paintings. But I never wanted to look at them when they were seeing the sketch for the first time for
a couple reasons.
A, I didn't want to see any disappointment if they were like, this bitch doesn't look like me. And B, it's such a private moment. Yeah. I remember that moment that I had when I first looked at myself. And so there was always this awkward, like, here you are. Oh, sorry. Here you are. let me not turn away from the mic. I'm a very dramatic person.
No, it's
I have a background in theater, so I'm going to try not to, to act it all out. 9 times out of 10, there were tears in their eyes or a glow about them. It was like I was seeing that switch. I wasn't experiencing it for them, but I knew what they were experiencing. Sometimes it was a, oh, that's what I look like. Or there were times that it was a, they were almost shocked to see how somebody else saw them or how an artist saw them. One lady in particular was very moved by how someone else's point of view of her. She had just seen herself as art, had never seen herself that way, and was just so put back by seeing herself in such a different. I mean, she's seen pictures of herself and seen, you know, all of this, but
yeah. It's really weird though when you see yourself in the mirror. If you see a picture of yourself, it doesn't disconnect you from your own self-image, right? Like that's
right.
I mean, that's even how body dysmorphia works.
Right.
I have body dysmorphia. When I look in the mirror, I don't, you know, you kind of look different.
Right.
But then if you see an artist's interpretation of it, it disconnects you from that and you can just be like, cool.
Well, and I don't include faces.
Yeah.
And I don't do that for a couple reasons. One of them is because I'm a newer artist and faces are a bitch.
I like the honesty.
Yeah.
Jill, how come there's never any hands in your work? Let's just, you know.
You will see that too. You will notice every now and then there are quite a few hands behind bags and like hidden behind flowers. If you want me to do a 8x10 hand, I got you covered. You want me to do an up close face? I'm I'm gonna get there.
Yeah.
But trying to do a little tiny realistic face or hand, it's not cute. Yeah. It's,
you don't want that to detract away from.
Yeah, you're gonna look real.
From the tits.
You're gonna look real busted. you're gonna have a lot of butterface action. Okay. So it's gonna be a whole book worth of butterface.
Jill, I love the way you did my body, but I just gotta say my face.
There's something that was, wrong.
That was what I was sensitive about. You really did it.
Yeah. But the second reason, which is actually, you know, much more legit, the reason why I have not worked on faces more is because I don't want you to focus on the face. The face is what we see all the time. The face is what... a lot of times we spend so much time, especially women, staring at our face, adding our makeup.
Your face is your identity.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. It's on our IDs. It's everywhere we go. It's what people know us by. People half the time aren't going to recognize us from the neck down unless we have a lot of identifying features, tattoos, whatever. Big old titties, whatever. they're not going to recognize us from the neck down. And I want that to be I don't want them to look at that and automatically go to their face. I don't want people, when they're looking at all the images together, to look, because that's what people are going to do. So you've got naked tits. People are going to notice the tits. But they're also going to look for the faces, and I don't want people doing that.
That's just what we do as humans. We have
exactly.
to... We're like, what's the face?
We want to identify, and whether it's because we're identifying whether it's somebody we know or just to put a face to it, we want to constantly put a face to things. Even before I came today, it was like putting the face, even though I'd seen you around and seen pictures, it was still putting a face to it. That if some reason it doesn't feel complete, but
there's danger if you don't know. Yeah.
True.
You have to
look
at face. You're like, oh. Yeah. So much intentions with our facial expressions, and we're born and bred to read people's face and read their intentions and know who they are in every single second. Like, there's a whole part of your brain that's dedicated to memorizing faces.
Exactly.
But then you take the face out of it and you have to focus on.
Exactly. Yeah. You have to focus on everything else. And it's been very important to me. And I may one day play with faces, but I don't really plan on it.
Sounds catchy, faces across Texas.
I mean seriously. I mean, I've got some other ideas with some T's across Texas, but
T's.
Some twats across.
Twats across Texas. That would
be cool. That'd be interesting.
Maybe. I don't know.
I wonder what's more, what the variance is. It's probably a lot more different. Well, no, it's probably about the same. Well, you know, the uniqueness.
Snowflakes, boo.
Snowflakes.
Snowflakes.
Yeah. I don't know. We are trying to move to California, so I thought about cunts across California.
Americans don't like that word.
I know.
They do not.
I do too. I love it. And one of my closest friends, or, you know.
This is what's going to get us banned. This is what.
Sorry.
The FCC is going to bang on our door. Like, we're letting y'all slide on all the fucks and everything, but cunts is like, that's.
Cunts getting y'all. it cracks her up every time I say it because it's so serious over there, you know. Like, that's like the worst over there. Yeah. And I'm like, I love using it. And it's like one of those words, like, to me, like everybody's a bitch to me. It don't matter if you're my best friend or I hate you or if you're an inanimate object. Like, it's a, like, this water bottle is a bitch.
Bitch,
and my
please.
Book is a bitch, and you're a bitch, and you're a bitch, and I'm a bitch, and my best friend is a bitch.
Yes,
that's kind of how cunt works for me, too. Yeah. I'm like, oh, I love you, cunt. And it's also like, you're a fucking cunt. Like, it works either way for me.
It's really effective.
I don't know. Well, pussy's kind of the same. Oh, can I say that?
Yeah, ooh, yeah.
You say whatever you want.
Cool.
No, I mean, I can appreciate vulgarity because
one of the things that we talked about cussing and our big thing is like, we're not gonna, like, if we have on like a doctor or professor or something, we're not just gonna start jumping into the vulgarity, but if they curse, then we're gonna curse because it's more, it's the authenticity, you
right
know? we're not gonna I mean, if somebody with a PhD or something like that, or anybody really, is okay with curse words, then why should anybody let that keep them from listening?
Right. You know?
If somebody's not going to listen because they're offended by the word fuck,
then that's then fine.
This is not the podcast for you today.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe the next one.
catch another episode. Yeah. Because I like to say pussy and cunt.
Yes.
And fuck. And bitch and cunt. And pussy.
I'm gonna open this with the George Carlin.
Oh, that'd be hilarious.
George Carlin bit.
You know, so I've had this thing I've wanted to do for years now, like a couple years. I remember.
Is it the calendar?
The calendar, yeah. So whenever dick pics first started becoming a thing, mm-hmm. you know, when like guys started anonymously sending greasy pictures of their penis.
Right, yeah. I've gotten quite a few.
Are like, the pictures themselves greasy or the penis?
Like, no,
it just looks, because
it's in the dark and people are using flashes and it just makes it look bad. It makes it look greasy and shiny.
I usually share them on my stories when I get them.
Good.
So, yeah, so it's like
everyone
when people started mm-hmm. doing that, I really started thinking about it. I was like, man, I want to do a calendar, but with dicks. Like, I want to do a 12-month calendar, but I really want to make a production out of it. So, I want to make like a tabletop set, just like with a hole in it, right? Like, you can have a whole little tiny miniature thing,
mm-hmm.
and then you would put your erect dick through the hole. And then I want to find somebody who's like a good seamstress and make little costumes and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And then, like, recreate famous scenes, but, like, with
like dicks. Casablanca, but with dicks.
Yeah, like, yeah. No, like, and just, and then the men would be credited, but you wouldn't know whose month, because there's a lot.
Yeah.
You know, like,
I mean,
you wouldn't put them per month. Yeah. Say, these are the guys that are in.
This is Joey's dick in December.
You're not doing that. You know, everybody would be on there, but it would be a mystery who's, but you know, because the thing with like your book and everything and body positivity with women is it's really positive. Women talk about body positivity all the time and body shaming and stuff like that, but it's kind of a silent thing with men.
It is.
Especially like with their
I think it's getting better.
It's getting better, but.
But maybe that's just because as we get older, we get more comfortable with our bodies, I guess you could
right,
say.
Right, yeah.
Just the. Women are cohesive in a lot of ways that men aren't, and women are kind of on the same page a lot of times when we're not, because we're more isolated emotionally. And it's just.
And women aren't afraid to admit it a lot of times.
And so, like, body images can be a really big deal for men, and people just don't know it because we don't say anything.
Yeah, absolutely. And, like, on the.
It's like, what are you, a bitch? What are you talking about?
No.
You're like, It was like, oh, dang, you're just a little bitch. And you're like, no, I just don't care.
I'm sensitive about the size of my pee-pee.
No, I don't even care.
Yeah.
And that's what you just end up doing. You just say, I don't care until you die.
And honestly, it is a shame.
Yeah.
On Instagram, I follow a lot of, like, body positive communities and stuff. And there is a major lack of representation in the male community. And you'll see some. A lot of times, it's gay males that are willing to come out and say, I'm a bear, or I'm a this or that, and I'm going to show my body, and I don't care.
Well, yeah, they have classifications of gayness by by their body type, right?
They're willing to come out in a crop top or, you know, whatever the situation may be, but they're willing to admit their flaws, they're upset, and they're accepted. I don't know what... I mean, obviously, I'm not a dude, so I don't, you know, all I can speak from is from the women's point of view, you know. But I know even just from conversations with my husband or whatever that it's definitely an issue that needs to be addressed. And I think that more men should step up.
I think that's, are we doing that?
Yeah, no, I think y'all are. Are we doing that in the, what did we name this place?
The Curiosity Clubhouse.
Clubhouse. Yeah.
I didn't forget already. That was only, 20 minutes ago?
Yeah.
That's okay. No, seriously, I mean, y'all should talk about it more. Y'all talk about your penises.
We try to. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think your idea is awesome.
Yeah,
I think you
like
should.
I think it's a cool idea. It would take a lot from different artists. Like you would, like I was saying, you'd have to have a scene, you know, you'd have to have a costume designer and a set designer and a photographer.
Yeah.
And it would be, it's just a, it's be a
and
big
a lot,
collab.
And a lot of trust.
A lot of trust too. Yeah.
A whole lot
yeah.
of trust.
And non-disclosure agreements.
Yes.
Yeah.
And see, and that was something that even I had, like, I wrote it out myself, and everybody giggled at me because
you had an agreement for this?
I had an agreement that it was just basically, I can use your likeness to create these images. I can put them in my book. I can share them on Instagram.
Right.
And I made them sign that they will always think they're a beautiful goddess.
That was part of the contract?
That was part of the contract. And I hand wrote it all and made copies at the Nederland Public Library.
Yeah. Shouts out to Nederland.
What?
Yeah.
Marion Hughes, library in the house.
Yeah.
Can't believe you used the library. What are you, a socialist?
Actually. I use the library for a lot with this project.
Yeah.
And it's... I actually got a call from one of the librarians that I had left one of the images on the scanner.
Oh, no.
Luckily, I know two of the librarians, and she was just like, we pulled it aside for you. And I was like, whoops.
It's art. Come on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, when a gentleman had found it, and he was like, I think an artist left some work on the scanner. And I was like, whoops. And, of course, it was one of the ones that, because I gave them all the choice whether or not they just wanted to be topless or if they wanted to go the full Monty. I mean, I don't know if it counts the full Monty for a woman. I don't know.
I mean, yeah, I don't know. It's the same idea.
Yeah.
And they're not British, so.
No, whatever. Yeah, whatever. It's also a musical. If you didn't know that.
The full Monty.
Yeah, they made that movie into a musical.
It's a good movie.
You got a little tidbit of information. My degree's in musical theater, so I could give you all kinds of those.
So I'm guessing that was the one that they found was the full Monty one.
They found the full Monty one. Yeah, it was really, really. I was a little embarrassed when I walked in to pick it up, but I don't really get embarrassed about those kind of things.
You're doing a book called Tits Across Texas. I know, I was about to say
I don't really get embarrassed, but it was just having to like go with my tail between my legs to pick up the thing that I had left there, getting the phone call that I had left it.
I might have made somebody uncomfortable.
Yeah,
probably just more embarrassed you left your work, honestly.
And it was like the day before the show, so I was like having to go pick it up right before it was like. To hang it up and display it, and it was just it was an awkward little situation. But they giggled at me, the librarians that knew me, and because they know me at the library because I'm there so often. They know me by name.
Well, let's take a short little break, and then we'll regroup, come back, we're gonna do a little advertising. Yeah,
cool. Yeah, let's do it.
Okay,
figure out what that crackle is.
Hey, this is Julia with Wake Up Beaumont Podcast. You are listening to the A to Z Podcast. A to Z Podcast Studios are funded in part by patrons on Patreon. If you would like to become a patron, visit patreon.com/A2Z.
I realize I don't get to send them back to school because I'm homeschooling them.
Oh, no.
Yeah, that's okay.
I don't envy you.
It's going to be better once we're back in school because then we'll have structure.
Yeah,
sure. Well, you can tire them out. So. Yeah. Tear his brain out.
Just go to the library, you know?
Just go to the library. That's all we're going
to
do.
Just going to go to the library,
Just got to go to the library. Make some, scan some copies.
Yeah. So what's the response been? What's the response been on this book?
It's been really good. We actually, going into it, I was planning on doing absolute everything myself. Like funding, which I did do most of the funding myself, but I did decide to do a Kickstarter just because the response was doing so well that I wanted to produce more copies than I was going to be able to do. And that's basically all the Kickstarter did was produce more copies than my original budget allowed me to do so. We were able to hit 2,000 in a month.
Well, yeah.
Which was just... like blew my mind.
Yeah.
Kickstarter is scary because you put in that number and if you don't get that number, like you don't get nothing.
Right. Yeah. That's why a lot of people use like Indiegogo and stuff. Yeah.
Exactly. But for me, it was more of a like, I want y'all to know that like this is how I'm doing pre-order because that's kind of how I did the pre-order situation too. Like this is how I'm doing pre-orders. You're for sure like I wanted that. What's the word I'm looking for? You know, that when somebody trusts you and there's a word forget it. Forget that word. Fuck that word. Obviously don't need that word.
Yeah.
Sucker. and I'm still trying to think of that word as I'm like cussing it out. Anyway, I don't. it don't matter because I made it.
Yeah.
I'm still like still thinking of it.
It's like you needed them to know
yes.
that what their money or what their
yes.
their donations were going to go towards.
Yeah, it was going directly towards just producing
more
copies
yeah.
of the book. Mm-hmm. The copies mm-hmm. were going directly towards them.
Mm-hmm.
Like it was going to guarantee that and that I was still going to make the book even if it didn't go through. Mm-hmm. It was just going to take X amount of time longer, blah blah blah. But that was not a problem. I got it. The books were, it was like 3 weeks from when I submitted the order to when they came to my doorstep.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Yeah, absolutely insane. The company that I went through was incredible. Like they sent me an actual hard copy to go through and verify and all that before I press the like final print.
I'm forgetting my words. The publisher, right? I guess you would call that. Well, it's not publishing.
It's like the printer. I feel like it's like becoming Pontypool. Have you ever seen that movie Pontypool? It's like a zombie movie, but it's based on words. And if you say a word too many times, like you get the virus.
I've never heard of that.
I hope it's not the word fuck, because we'd be
we'd be undead.
Yeah.
It's some kind of situation like that, but I feel like all this forgetting words, it made me think of that movie. Anyways, look up the movie Pontypool. I remember not liking it, but my husband loved it. It was a really weird concept. Anyway. But Don't even. It has nothing to do with anything.
No, it's fine.
Now we're talking about zombies. Yeah. Zombie tits. That'll be the next one.
That's a good concept. I mean, I like it. Yeah,
it's also super creepy. I don't know how.
What's the rate of decay? What goes first?
Yeah.
Well, you'd be the artist. It'd be up to you to do all that.
Yeah, no. Okay. We're moving on. Moving on. The printer got it to me really fast. So I was able to actually get the Kickstarter people who kickstarted, mm-hmm. if you will. I'm sure there's a word for them.
Kickstarters.
There's a word.
Supporters.
The supporters, yeah. I was able to get them their copies by late May.
Wow.
Which is crazy. Like I didn't expect it till June. I initially only ordered 150 books, and I'm down to 50 of them now.
Yeah.
Which I thought that I was going to take a bunch and get them into retail, like, you know, like kind of put them in a couple little places here and there. I do have some at Cactus. But otherwise, I think right now I'm just going to sell them through my website.
Yeah.
And then I'll probably place in the future and like a second order to maybe get into some places of looking into Houston and Austin and maybe other areas.
Like some bookstores.
Yeah, stuff. Some bookstore. Yeah. I actually found a feminist bookstore in Austin that I'm going to call and be like, hey, maybe I should wear my hat when I go.
There you go.
Probably so, yeah.
but yeah, I'm going to check into some bookstores and some like local like indie record stores, that kind of thing that I've seen this situation be like, you know.
Yeah, I think you'd get a really good response, honestly.
Yeah, I hope so. I would like to see it, like, at least in a couple brick and mortars, just to say that I got it into some. And especially because there are quite a few women from Austin in there. Mm-hmm. I'd especially like to see it in Austin, even if it's just at one or two little places. I even had more women from Austin wanting to participate. So once again,
and you had to travel to them, right?
Yes,
a lot of this is, you know, like little travel.
Yeah,
I see. There's a lot of maps and stuff in here, and all that. Yeah,
I went to I took a couple trips to Austin that were seriously just back to back schedulings, sketching the women. My first trip, it was the first time I'd ever been to Austin by myself.
Mm.
I did not remember how spread apart it was, mm-hmm. and I did not take that in consideration when I scheduled any of my girls. So I was literally I would have one in South Austin,
oh, no.
and then like 30 minutes later have one all the way North Austin.
Yeah, and it takes like 2 hours to get there.
Exactly, exactly. So my weekend was just completely fucked. Yeah. I had all these plans that I was gonna like visit friends, and I was also gonna do this and that, and
No, I-35 will throw that out the window.
Yeah, man. Yeah. The whole weekend was just sketching, which was fine. That was what I was initially there
sketching
for.
Sketching and driving.
Sketching and driving. Yeah. Yeah. I got to know Austin really well. Mm-hmm. Got lost a whole lot. Then the next time I went, I was a little better about planning that out. I still got lost a couple times. I ended up at a park with peacocks. That was pretty cool.
That's pretty cool, yeah.
Yeah, I'm looking at your peacock here. yeah, it was crazy. I like pulled over to like map and I like looked up in my rear view mirror and I was like, what the fuck? That's a peacock. And so then I like hobble out of my car. And I mean, this is a really funny image because I'm like chasing this peacock, like hobbling with my cane.
Like, hey, come here.
I'm like, come back here. Where are you going? You know,
Didn't get attacked because they can be very mean.
Oh, well. Yeah. Now you tell me. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks. Where were you then?
I don't know. I mean, they're dinosaurs, so they can...
I guess that's, you know. But I did. So I follow. I go around this little trail. I got my cane. He disappeared. So I'm like, what? This is a disappearing peacock. Did I make this shit up?
Straight tripping.
I'm like, what is going on, Austin?
Yeah.
And I, like, peek around this corner. And I'm like, I got my camera ready because I'm, like, recording. I'm like, I'm going to find these peacocks. And I, like, peek over this little thing. And there were like six or seven of them. There was a whole area of peacocks. So y'all go to Austin. I'll tell you where the peacocks are. I went to Dallas, like Fort Worth, Dallas area. Mm-hmm. Desiree and I actually went on that trip together. Let's see, where else did I go? I was supposed to make a trip to Longview, and that ended up not working out. So I had the gal from there sent me. I used to live in Longview, so I have a couple friends out there.
I'm sorry.
Right.
Saying that as a person who lives in Beaumont, they're basically the same thing.
Yeah. Yeah. We lived there for a very short time. My son was born there, and that's about the only thing that matters about Longview. the only thing. There is a really good sandwich place there called It'll Do. Shout out to It'll Do, who will never listen. Probably have real good sandwiches if you're ever in Longview. But the reception overall it's been crazy. Like I had people asking me to come to all kinds of parts of Texas that I was just like, if you can get a couple more people together, I can't come there for just one person.
Like, can you come to El Paso? You're like, you better find 15 people.
Exactly. Exactly. And you better pay for my room and my board, and you better buy me some cheesecake or something. Because it's a long trip.
How did you find these women, or how do they find you? Because it seems to be that a lot of these people are very disconnected, and it's not like you're just exhausting your friend pool. These are strangers.
Yeah,
right?
I did not know about 75% of these women.
So do you have? Yeah. You must have like an online presence or something that really pulls
Instagram.
Them in.
It pretty much is where most of them came from. If I did not know them directly, which most of the people that I knew directly, it came off of Facebook because they tend to respond. I don't, for some reason, it's weird. Local people respond faster on Facebook, but I don't know. Anyway. So if they were local, that's typically where I got them from, how I hooked them in. And then Instagram is where everybody else. And I really just made like a call to arms, if you will. I just made a post saying I want to do this project. I'm looking for tits of all shape, size, color, you know, all backgrounds. If you're interested, give me a holler. And I started getting a couple little messages, and then a couple turned into a couple dozen, and then a couple dozen turned into 40. And it started January 2018, and I sketched the last woman in April of this year. And
you had a book by the end of May. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I guess you were building it as you...
Yeah, I started doing a lot of the building early January of this year. There were just a few women that I was waiting for that I knew for certain that I wanted to get in, that we'd already made arrangements or whatever the situation was, that I had either started working on them, I had their sketches, or whatever the situation was. So I'd already started like getting it built. It was just a matter of plugging in and a few things here and there, at the end of April, early May before I got it submitted. a lot of work.
Yeah.
It's kind of crazy to think that it was just about a year and a half of.
I mean, that's impressive because nonstop, books. Yeah, books usually take a long time. Like Gonzalo does that Pollo Man thing, and he's been working on that thing for. I mean, it's a bunch of really detailed illustrations, but he's been working on that thing for 5 years, and it's not even going to come out until like the year after next. I think. And he got a publishing deal, but it's like, it's so fast that you got it out, and it's really cool. It's just so cool. Like,
oh, thanks.
Yeah, it's great. It's it kind of captures. It captures a lot of things that are, you know, it's, we obviously love anything Texas. That's kind of how me and Aaron are, but it's just so, it's cool to see kind of the body positivity thing, based in such a state like what we have. Like Texas is such like kind of a conservative place and everything like that, but it captures that side of Texas. And I think it's really great.
Yeah. I think that, I had no clue what I was getting into. Like I said, I thought maybe a dozen women, if that would holla at me, slide into my DMs. I didn't expect 40 women to want to get naked for me, especially so many of them being strangers. Yeah. But they were just so moved and wanted to, I mean, I don't want that to sound pretentious, but they were just so moved by what it was about and wanted to be a part of something that they felt was so, they felt that it was going to be bigger than I even imagined it to be. And I still haven't wrapped my head around.
Well, it's got to feel good that somebody put importance into something that you believed in.
Right. Yeah. I mean, that for something to be, for someone to believe in what you, I mean, like some on such a minuscule level, I mean, like your goal, your dream, your whatever. I mean, this hasn't always been my dream, so I can't, like, I don't want to call it my dream. But for someone to believe that much into something that you just, like, I'm gonna do this. It's incredible for someone to put that much trust in you. I mean, because every single one of these women had to put the utmost amount of trust in me, in multiple ways. But for them to be able to do that and not only put that trust in me as a person, but put that trust in the project, and no, I mean, there's copies of this going to England. I mean, it's going,
it's pretty wild,
it's all over the United States so far. It's crazy. I met some people at brunch that were like in Houston, and they were like, holy crap, that's cool. They came down for the opening.
They're like, we like Boobies.
Yeah, it was crazy, you know? I mean, like, met people from all over that I've been able to connect with over it. Not just this, but just my art in general. Project that I did last year where I was going around hiding. I would paint these little 4x6 inspirational cards. I would say shit like, some of them said you go girl, but like you're magic, or you're fucking amazing, or rise up, or shine bright, or just whatever. And I would hide them in bathrooms and fitting rooms. And I reached out to Instagram and said, does anybody want a packet of these? And I, last year, in the midst of doing this project, also, sorry, I sounded real braggy there. In the midst of doing that, I painted 1,000 of those 4x6 cards, and they reached 42 states and 16 different countries. and that's all just from
That's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Just from posting on Instagram.
You're like an Instagram pro then.
Yeah. Maybe. It's just something about what you, I don't know, it's great. It's like something about what you believe in these things is, it obviously touches a lot of people.
It makes me feel good. And it, like I said, I haven't always done art. And sometimes I feel like, this is going to sound real dumb, but sometimes I feel like I don't deserve to have done this.
Because you're not like a,
we all,
an artist.
We all feel like
you're
that all
right.
the time.
Yeah. Because there are people who have been doing art their whole lives that, you know, are still working and still, and I mean, it's not like I've made it or something. I mean, I made this
by
myself. Sex
sells, man, you know? tits sell.
Yeah.
But I don't know. It's it started out as a hobby, and then it became something that was a healing module for me. And then I realized that I could help spread that healing to other people. And, you know, we kind of heal ourselves by healing others. And I need a whole lot of fucking healing. And not that I'm doing this just for the sake of But I got a lot of time on my hands. Yeah. And if I got a lot of time and that's all I got is time. And I mean, I know that in essence, that's all anybody has. But I can't work and I won't.
Well, some of us have like really well working bodies.
Yeah.
So we have a little more than time too. Right. You know?
Yeah. And that's kind of what I mean. You know, I have a wheelchair to look forward to and I have more surgeries and more medication. Mm. And I try not to focus on those things. I try to focus on what I can do during that time that I do have. And I mean, it's not like I'm dying or something, but I, this is the good I can do. And if it's just ends up being a hobby forever that I just make little books that I sell through my website and I sell nail polish on the side and I collect a disability check in the meantime, I mean, so be it. If it just reaches, you know, Southeast Texas and beyond, that's fine with me. It's I know for sure it's touched 40 people, and that's
just the people in the book, not counting the people that are getting the books.
Yeah.
Yeah. You said a whole lot of things that are very positive, and this whole project has been really. Have you had any negative feedback? Has anybody like slid up in your DMs being like, "What are you doing? Cover those titties."
I get negative messages in my DMs. So my Instagram has been kind of quiet.
Yeah.
Lately, only because I pushed and worked so hard, and then I was like, I don't want to fucking post another thing for the rest of forever.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Actually made a post this morning saying like, I will come back. I promise. I mean, like I've reposted about my book, but I haven't posted any new art. I haven't even created any new art. I don't want to say in how long because it's been too long. It's kind of sad. But it was just I went and I painted and I painted and created all this and then put the book together. And then it was putting together the event and the flyers for the event and this for the event and all that. And then it was just like, now I'm going to just stop for a minute.
Yeah.
And then we'll decide what to do next. When I'm more active on there, because I'm not afraid to show my body, I get a whole lot of shit, you know, from people either being sexually, you know, overtly sexual towards me in my DMs or being rude, like, you don't need to wear that or you need
like
to cover
up. Shaming,
body shaming, whatever. I get both of those kind of things. And then I get, like, there's ways to be body positive without it having to be nudity.
So you get preachy people, too? Stuff
Yeah, absolutely. And it's not, like, I don't get inundated with it. Mm-hmm. It could be so much worse.
Yeah.
Most of the time, I just ignore it. If they're polite, I will politely respond back.
Mm-hmm.
Just because I don't want to be a bitch and just ignore the haters. Yeah. I mean, I'll ignore the straight up haters.
Yeah.
And I will post a dick pic on my freaking stories with their name and everything. I will.
Don't send her any dick pics.
Yeah.
unless you want her to show the world.
I will put you on blast.
They're like, that is my kink, is to be shamed.
You're like, but I want you to show it.
Yeah.
But my kink is kink shaming.
it's a strange thing too, because we live. I mean, the book is Tits Across Texas and stuff, and we live in a very perceived conservative state, right? Where you think that like people are like going to shame you, but also paradoxically too, this is like one of the few states where it's not illegal to have your tits out.
Mm-mm.
It's not.
It's not illegal to have your tits out in Texas. No, Mm-mm. it's not. And also, it's one of the few. It's like, well, it's not. I guess they're not. Few, but you can breastfeed in public.
Mm.
Like you can't get a ticket for any of that stuff, you know. So Texas is pretty cool about that. I mean,
and you can't go to any truck stop without finding like a Texas bikini or a magnet with some chick with big tits to say welcome to Texas.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, we like tits.
We like
babies for tits and Texas.
We do.
I'm gonna make a magnet that says that. Or a t-shirt.
No, you should make a magnet that says that.
I'll make a magnet that says that. A t-shirt or a sticker.
I'm sure you'll sell like 2,000 of them for sure. That's what's next.
That's what's T is for.
So yeah, what do you have? What do you have coming up next? Like, what are you thinking?
Oh man, I honestly
still just chilling.
I mean, right now I am doing some chilling. Chilling. Sounds really cool. I am very cool, you guys. I like to chill. While I am chilling, I am going to think about what to do next. Yeah. I have seriously considered a volume 2, just because there have been quite a few people reach out as far as wanting to be a part of the project.
Yeah.
And because the response has been above what I expected. You know, there's a part of me that I'm such a minimalist, and we live in a tiny house, not like an official tiny house, but it's 500 square feet, so it's pretty tiny.
Very small.
I'm a like get rid of things constantly, yeah. And so I have to remind myself that I don't have to get rid of all of this book before I do anything else.
Yeah,
I have to remind myself that copies of this book can sell forever. Like that's what people do; they make a book and then sell copies for years and years and years. Yeah. They don't make a book and then stop making copies of it.
Then there's second edition.
Exactly. Yeah. And so there's lots of things I'm reminding myself that Tits Across Texas, even if volume 2 comes, volume 1 is not over.
Yeah.
Right.
And it's not going to be over just because...
Well, it's not a volume 2 without volume 1.
Exactly. Yeah. And just because the party and all of that, and it's kind of like...
You kind of feel like you're done with this. This needs to go.
Exactly. And I'm trying... not to, and I don't know what that is, and maybe like okay, so I mentioned before I have a background in theater, and anytime after we did a show there was always this like post-show depression that comes.
Right,
it's like, you know,
it's the day after Christmas.
Exactly And so I'm having a little bit of that with it, like the show's already been over, like this thing I planned for a year and a half, you know, which even though that doesn't sound like a lot to for some people, but for me, when that's all I'm focusing on,
yeah, that's a long time.
Night and day, and I mean, like in the middle of the night, I'd be like researching, you know. I'm just a little like in dreamland. I'm also a little tired, a lot tired. But I haven't even had the desire to paint, even not in a negative way, but just in a, like, I'm not ready. And I'm very much a, like, I need to be ready. I need, like, I'm not going to paint just because, like, oh, I need to paint today.
Yeah.
Like, that just doesn't feel right to me. And because I'm not... because it's such a healing thing, because it's such an emotional thing for me, it's so like I need to be connected with it, and I'm not gonna just sit down and paint for the sake of painting. There's no point in that to me. And like, sure, I don't want to get out of practice or whatever, but I was never in practice because like I don't know what the fuck I'm doing.
Yeah.
I'm just making this shit up as I go. I didn't draw a body for the first time until myself. Less than 2 years ago. So, yeah. I mean, like, I don't know what I'm doing.
Well, you didn't do this for other people. You did it for you.
Exactly. Yeah. And so...
Even though it did help other people.
Right. So, yeah, I would say to keep an eye out for a possible part do. I don't know.
I took French in high school.
I just added the extra ones there. I just... Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do.
You should, maybe it's Tits Across Texas Pair. The Pair. Nice Pair.
Nice.
Volume 2. Nice Pair.
Like movie names. Two, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I was kind of.
You're a dork.
I did.
That's my role. Yes.
Yes. I agreed. And I just met you. And I'm like, yes. it's like a natural response to just
agree. You've learned what you need to know. Just in a day. Yeah.
I haven't really talked about it yet or even told anybody, but I did have it made into an ebook as well that you can download. You can't get it through my website, but you can get it through the printer's website.
Okay.
And so I kind of wanted to wait until the party was over and all that to announce it. Just because.
So where can people find your book?
So you can find it in person. You can find it at Cactus Cactus in Nederland on 11th Street. I don't know the address, but you have the internet. Google. So look up Cactus Cactus.
They're on all the social media.
And then online, you can find it at, let me see if I can remember my website. It is Jill Waldrep Art. And Waldrep is W-A-L-D-R-E-P. Jill Waldrep Art dot bigcartel.com. You can find me on Instagram at, oh shit, what's my Instagram?
Art
by Jill. It's like the easiest thing ever. And I'm like, what the fuck? At Art by Jill Waldrep. And it has a link in it as well.
Yeah. And we'll share all these in the show notes.
Yeah. I mean, and you can, if you're local, you can message me directly. We'll hook you up with delivery or whatever.
Yeah. What are the books running for?
They're $30.
$30. That's good for, it's for an art piece.
Yeah. I mean, and there, it's 108, 110 pages, something like that. So full color, full live in color.
It's not skimpy.
No.
You know?
No, it's a good size book.
Yeah.
It's
pretty on your coffee table.
Yeah.
Till your in-laws come over.
Like, even then, it's kind of, I don't know, it has everything that people want. I think my mom would want this
book, I wouldn't
honestly
put that book up for nobody.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, Jill, it's been so good hanging out with you. Nice to meet you.
Thank you guys for having me.
Yeah, it's been a fun time.
We've had a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Have you had fun?
I have had fun. Yes.
Good.
I had a good time.
So that's Jill Waldrep, Tits Across Texas. Get her book. Go check her out.
Get at her. Get at the book. You know, you heard.
Drop into her DMs.
Slide into those DMs.
We're all about body positivity.
Go out to Cactus Cactus.
Boobies.
Pick up a succulent and a book.
Succulent a book while you're wearing your crop top.
While you're wearing your crop top, that's right.
All right, this has been A to Z. Underneath her red sweater, she's a big deal, go get her. There'll be some dramas inside your pajamas tonight.
All right, well, I want to say a big special thanks to our guest this episode, Jill. Thank you for coming up our stairs and just putting up with us this whole time. It was a great time. I really enjoyed it, and I think our audience really did too.
Yeah, special shout out to our patrons too: Jordan Stringer, Lance Killian, Brian Castino, Doug Waldrep, Michael Saar, Ben McClellan, Randy Edwards, Ali Gillette, and newest patron, Allison Pierce. I love that this list just keeps getting longer. It makes me so happy.
It's very humbling. Yeah,
it is.
Yeah,
and it's like so many people that are supporting us and helping us do what we do. And we love you guys. And I can't wait. I hope you get your shirts and share them with people. And maybe we'll do dog costumes for you next.
That'd be cool.
I think most of y'all are kind of dog owners. I mean, even the cat owners. The cat owners will give you shirts too.
Because
I know that it would irritate your cats. And that would be great for me. But if you're interested in becoming a patron, head on over to patreon.com/A2ZBMT.
All right, and on our next episode, we have Desiree Klapis. You know, she's at the Giving Fields. She's at Mid-County Victory Garden. She's literally
Cactus Cactus.
A woman about town.
She cuts hair.
That's it. She's one of she's a mover and a shaker. She's kind of like, I don't know, whatever the coolest version of us is, you know, where we like do a bunch of stuff. She's like that. But we talk about plants and what's that called? Horticulture? Isn't that what that's called?
Yeah.
We talk about all kinds of stuff. And it's really interesting. This is one of those episodes, kind of like Rachel with Wild Earth Texas, is one where we don't know that much. So we ask a lot of questions. Mm. And if you listen, you'll be learning it alongside us.
With us. And if you have a guest that you think would be a good fit, send us a message. Let us know. Drop a line. You can write us. You can tell a friend of a friend to tell us something.
Have your people call our people. We'll set something up.
Yeah.
You heard?
Yeah. Well, see you next time.